administration of the Spirit. How many know that we're living in a dispensation of the Holy Spirit? And let me say this so these kids can understand me. That now that if you're born again and if you're saved, God sends the Holy Spirit to live in your heart. And it's the job of the Holy Spirit to manifest or to show God's character and God's glory in our lives. Now, Jesus said this to his disciples in St. John. He said that they'll know that you're my disciples by the love that you show one to another. So the way that people can tell that you're born again or that you're a Christian is that the love that we show one to another. How many know that when you're born again, you're supposed to walk in love? Amen? I was reading in, what is it, 2 Peter 1:23. The Bible said we have been born again, not of the corrupt seed, but of the incorruptible seed, which is the word of God, which lives and abides forever. How many know that we have been born? If you are a Christian, you're now born of God. We're born of the agape seed, of the seed of love. When I came here today, God began to speak to me and say certain things in my spirit. And he said, what my people need to understand is this, that I love them. And when I give you covenant, God's covenant is his word. God has made a covenant with you. In that covenant, God promised to heal. God promised to love you. God promised to lead you. God promised to guide you. God promised to give you prosperity. This is a part of the covenant of God. That's why you got to know the Bible. The Bible said that we got to study to show ourselves approved, a workman who need not to be ashamed, rightly divided in the word of God. So the only way you can know the promises and the blessings of God for your life is that you got to read your Bible. You know? You can't be like I used to be a long time ago. It sat on the shelf for years. Amen. All I did is look at it. But when I got born again, I started picking this up and started finding out what belongs to me. How many know that your inheritance is in the Bible? Your spiritual inheritance. What you mean by inheritance? That means that when Jesus came and he died for you, then just like in a natural will, like some of y'all, I got a mother. My father been passed away, but I have a mother. You know, she owned a house. She got certain things she owned. But when she passed away, then I'm going to inherit, me and my brothers and sisters, going to inherit her house. We're going to inherit her property, her land. It's going to be given to us. And so it's the same way when Jesus died. How many know that Jesus left us an inheritance? And the inheritance is life everlasting. The inheritance is that one day that we're going to go back and we're going to live with God for a little while. Amen. I have to say a little while because the Bible said that Jesus is going to come back and set his kingdom up on the earth. Heaven is not where we're going to stay at all our life. God is going to make a new heaven and a new earth, and we're coming back to the earth to live. Amen. I don't know if y'all know that or not, because so many people got their mindset on heaven is their home. But heaven ain't where you're gonna stay at all your life. Amen. Jesus is gonna, he's gonna make a new heaven and a new earth, and we're gonna come back, and the Bible said we're gonna rule on the earth. But the difference is we're gonna have an eternal body. We're gonna have a body that won't die anymore. We're gonna have a body that won't have sickness, won't have disease anymore. Amen. All it's gonna be is life, the life of God. We'll be able to talk to Jesus forever, you know? So that's a part of our inheritance. It's life everlasting. The Bible said in St. John 3:16 that God so loved the world that he that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believe on him should not perish, but shall have everlasting life. The goal of God is to give us life. The goal of God is for us to live forever. Well, somebody said, why God want me to live forever? Because God want to talk with you. God want to fellowship with you. God want to, amen, he want to reveal himself to you. He wants you to know him. Amen. And that's why he's giving us life everlasting, because it's always been the will of God for him to fellowship with mankind. I don't know if y'all read your Bibles, but if you read over in Genesis, and when God created the heavens and the earth, and then he created the Garden of Eden, the Bible said that God walked in the garden, that God talked with Adam, God fellowshiped with Adam. Amen. Every day God would come down, amen, and just talk to him and fellowship. You know, we don't know everything that God told Adam, but they was constantly in fellowship. And that's the will of God for each and every one of us. God wants fellowship. God want to talk with us. It's possible that God can talk to you if you want to hear it. Let's open our Bible. And the reason I said that was because the Spirit of God is what brings our inheritance. Without the Holy Spirit, we can't receive what God has to offer us. And so the Bible said that the Spirit, or the Holy Spirit, and you got different names, the Holy Spirit, some people call it the Holy Ghost, but how many know that the Holy Spirit is supposed to be your down payment or your guarantee that God is coming back to get us? You know, it's just like, let me try to make it plain as simple as possible. It's just like Christmas coming up. Well, it has come and gone, but just say Christmas time. Okay, say, you tell your mom, I want a bicycle. Well, mom may not have all that money to go get that bicycle at one time. What she do? She go to a Walmart or wherever she may go. She put a down payment, right? What do the down payment do? The down payment holds that until she pays it off. And now after she pay it off, then she can go back and get it, right? But if she don't pay for it, guess what? They'll take it, they'll put it back on the counter, and somebody else can come and buy it. Well, the Holy Spirit is our down payment from God. Mommy. That God is coming back to get us. Now the Bible says, he that has not the Spirit of Christ is none of his. But if you have the Spirit of God, if you're born again and the Holy Spirit lives on the inside of you, well, the Holy Spirit is your guarantee that God is coming back to get you. Do y'all understand that? That the Holy Spirit is your guarantee that God is coming back. So if his Spirit is in your heart, that's your guarantee that he's coming back to receive you to himself. And guess what? If you're born again, then you have the Spirit of God living on the inside of you. And so that means, in the simplest terms, is that you don't have to worry about whether you go into heaven or not if his Spirit is in your heart. And if you're born again. The Bible says in Romans 10:9-10, the Bible said that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believe unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. So when you receive Jesus Christ into your heart by believing and by confessing, then he comes and he lives on the inside of you. Now, I don't know about y'all, but that's an awesome statement to realize that the Spirit of God lives on the inside of you. You know? And if you need to talk to God, God can talk to you from your heart. How many know that God lives in your heart? He lives in your heart. He's on the inside of you. And if you, you know, and I've learned this over the years, that if I need an answer, if I need direction, whatever I need for my life, all I got to learn to do is just hear the Spirit of God on the inside of me. And guess what? He'll lead me. He'll guide me, the Bible said, into all truth. And so tonight, really what I want to talk about is the administration of the Spirit. And in order for the Spirit of God to work in you, first you got to be born again. You got to be saved. You know? You got to be filled with the Holy Ghost. You know? And you know, unfortunately, in the church, we think the Holy Ghost is just speaking in tongues, falling in the middle of the floor, dancing and shouting. But that's not all the Holy Spirit is. The Holy Spirit is the third person of the Trinity. And the Holy Spirit is a teacher. He's a tutor. He's a guide. How many know that the Holy Spirit comes to guide us, to give us direction, to teach us the ways of God? You know, I want to try to keep it as simple as possible. But let's go on and go to Corinthians, because I don't want to get too far out there. First, then I said 2 Corinthians chapter 3. We'll start with verse 3. And we're not going to be long. And this is the Apostle Paul. And I'm going to take my time and go through this and kind of break it down. I might not get through all of it tonight. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. I'm going to start with verse 3. Amen. It said, "For as much as ye are manifested, declared to be the epistles of Christ." Y'all know what an epistle is, don't you? You don't do. It's the Bible. The Bible said that we're living epistles. We're living Bible. We're supposed to be the living word. How do you know that we're supposed to have the word of God in our hearts, that when people see us, you know, they can actually get a word from God? Why? Because God's Spirit, God's word is in our heart. So Paul said, that we are epistles of Christ, and that we are read of all men. How do you know that people are supposed to be able to look at your life and see Jesus? You know, and I'm trying to make it as simple as possible. It's, you know, that means that as a Christian, we're supposed to have the character of love. No hatred. We're not supposed to hate people. We're not supposed to gossip, backbite, talebearer, and all that kind of stuff. We the Christian folks don't supposed to, you know, and I'm trying to make it plain. Christian folks don't supposed to walk around drunk and high and cussing and lying and stealing and doing all kinds of stuff. Why? Because if you're born again, guess what happens? Your nature changes. You know? Now, it don't mean Christians don't make mistakes. You know? And I found out every Christian is not empowered. Every Christian don't have the indwelling of the Holy Ghost. And at the same time, if you don't know the Bible, then you'll think you have to do all that stuff that the world do. You know? So, just say myself, for instance, as a Christian. You know, I try to love everybody. You know? I try to live a life that's acceptable to God. And also, I try to set an example for those that I minister to. So, and I'm trying to make this simple as possible. So, that means as a Christian and as a minister, that Pastor Barnes don't have no business. You come down the street and you hear me cussing one day, being mean as the devil. Well, that's not the nature of a Christian. That's actually the nature of your flesh. That's a sinful nature. That's not the nature of the Holy Spirit. And so when the Holy Spirit comes in, it actually is supposed to bring the nature of God. And what is God's nature? God's nature is love. And that's kindness, gentleness, meekness. All those kind of things are supposed to be a part of our nature if you're born again. You know, I'm trying to make it simple as possible, because, and sometimes grown folk don't get it either. supposed to change you. You're not supposed to be the same. Now, okay, God, I'm just being honest and being simple. See, I remember at a time when I used to drink, party, go to the club, and do all that kind of stuff. But when I got born again, Jesus took all that stuff out of me. You know, I don't do it no more. Why? Because the Spirit of God transformed me. It changed my life. You know, and what I'm saying in the basic, you know, in the simplest form, that when you become born again, you're really supposed to change. But you can't change without the Holy Spirit. You got to come, amen. And that's why you have to come to church to get help. And if there are people in life that make mistakes, there are Christian folks that still go to the club, there are Christian folks that still get drunk, but they need to submit their life to Jesus so Jesus can help them. So being a Christian don't mean you're perfect. Being a Christian means that when I need help, yeah, I can come to Jesus, and Jesus said, I'll help you if you need it. But you got to want help. You got to allow him to help you. So one of the purposes of the Holy Spirit is that when he comes in, he starts changing, rearranging our lives. To now, I can look over my life. I've been preaching for 34 years. I can look over my life and say, now, you know what? God, I remember when I used to do that. Thank you for delivering me. You know? I was thinking about it yesterday. I said, I remember when I used to buy all that beer and all that alcohol. I said, God, I could have bought a whole lot of stuff with that money. You know? But now that Jesus changed me, guess what? I don't do that anymore. So what I'm trying to say, part of the administration or the working of the Spirit is that the Spirit of God comes in and it changes our lives. You know? And I know to the natural mind, sometimes it seems like it's crazy when folks, you know, they shout, they lift their hands, they speak in tongues, they do all, because the Bible said one of the evidence of the Holy Spirit being in your life in Acts 2, they're talking about when the day of Pentecost was fully come, talk about how that the Spirit of God came in like a mighty rushing wind, and how that they spoke in tongues as the Spirit of God gave them utterance. So when the Spirit of God comes on the inside of you, amen, it'll give you a heavenly language. And so when you're talking about the ministration of something, you're actually talking about the working of the Spirit. So when you're born again and you receive the Holy Spirit, he's supposed to be leading your life and guiding your life. You know? So I want to encourage you today, get in a place where you allow the Holy Spirit to guide you. And you know, I always say this, you're not too young for the Holy Spirit to use you. I've been to churches where little kids prophesy, praying for people, and the Holy Spirit uses it. So it don't have nothing to do with age. It got everything to do with, do you want to give your heart to God? Do you want God to use you? Do you love it? Because how many know that God loves us? And that's why he sent his Spirit to live on the inside of us, so the Holy Spirit can help us. Now, I got a little boy, he's 7, and I got 1 4. I remember when my little boy was 2 years old, because he grew up in church, because mom and dad grew up in church. My little boy would, sometime when I would get up and preach, he'd come and help me. He said, Daddy, I helped you lay hands. I helped you pray. He would just come up there, and sometimes he'll just look at me and put his head on my head and start praying for me. You know why? Because we start training him early. We start teaching him early. The Bible said you train a child up in the way that it should go, then it might depart. But guess what? The Bible said that they'll come back. So we got to make sure we train our children up in the ways of the Holy Spirit, because guess what? If we don't get our young folks filled with the Holy Spirit, they're going to do just like we did. You know? They're going to try to find peace in the wrong places. They'll try to find peace, and I can say this about my own life, I tried to find peace in a bar, drinking. I tried to find peace in women. I tried to find peace in a whole lot of different things. But when I got born again and born of the Spirit, then I realized the peace that I really want comes from God. And so we want to make sure that we God, what we call the peace of God, the shalom of God, it comes through the Holy Spirit. So now that I'm born again, I don't have to find peace in a bottle. Peace is smoking a joint. You know why? Because I'm born of the Holy Spirit, and now I get my peace from God. You know, and I want to say to our young people and to everybody, listen, get to a place where you allow the Holy Spirit, where He can give you peace, where He can guide you, where He can direct you. Let me interrupt so I can get out of here. It said, for as much as ye are manifested and declared to be the epistles of Christ, ministers by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tablets of stone, but in fleshly tablets of the heart. Listen to this closely. For as much as ye are manifested, declared to be the epistles of Christ, ministers by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in the tablets of stone, but in fleshly tablets of the heart. Now, let me explain this to you right quick. Y'all know who Moses is, right? Have y'all ever watched the Ten Commandments, that movie? The cartoon? Okay, I have. I still watch it. I was watching it the other day. But you know, so the Ten Commandments came by Moses. What are the Ten Commandments? Thou should not steal, thou should not kill, thou should not bear false witness. So God, when Moses went up on the mountain of Mount Sinai, God gave him the Ten Commandments. And why did God give them the Ten Commandments? So that He could teach the people how to live, how to treat one another. You know? Did y'all know that in the old covenant? Unlike today, if somebody just say, and I hate to use the worst example, but I did. You know, like if somebody killed somebody in the Old Testament, do you know, in some cases, they would take the dead body and tie it onto their body, to their body right away. Why? Because they took somebody else's life. They would have to carry that physical body, that dead body, they would actually have to carry it on their back. Because one of the commandments was, thou should not kill. You know, and when you study the Old Testament, it was rough. But we're not under the law. We're under the grace of Jesus. You know what that means? That God's grace is, when you make a mistake because of Jesus, God forgives you. But under the law, if you make a mistake, they kill you. You know, if a woman was committing adultery cheating on her wife, you know what they would do? They would put her in the middle. They would put her in the middle of the road, and they would stone her to death. Now that's under the law. Now they still do that in some Arab nations, where they'll cut your hand off if you steal. You didn't know that. You get caught stealing in some country, they'll cut your hand off. You know. But we're not under the law. We're under grace. Aren't y'all glad we're under grace? Because guess what? If we weren't under grace and we made mistakes, all of us in here would be dead today. Because we all still make mistakes. But it's because of the grace of God, the love of God, because God loves us so much, He sent Jesus to die for us so that when we make mistakes, then the blood of Jesus covers all our sins. How many know the only reason we can worship God and come into the house of God and receive salvation is because of Jesus? None of us are good on our own. But it's the blood of Jesus that was shed for us. You know? So, let's finish me because I'm trying to keep it simple. I don't want to. Now listen to this. Not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God. Not in tablets of stone, but in fleshly tablets of the heart. So that means now, God don't write the commandments on stones. He didn't put them in your heart. Now somebody said, how did they get in my heart? Well, let me say it to you like this to make it simple. Now, we want to keep it simple. Have anybody ever started to do something wrong, and on the inside, you just knew you weren't supposed to do it? You can hear it. You know it. you know, mama tell you not to do it, daddy tell you not to do it, but you decide I'm gonna go on and do it anyway. But all the time in your heart, you know, I know that's wrong. I was supposed to do that. But you go on and do it. Well, guess what? The Holy Spirit in your heart, that's Him talking to you. See, we have it by the Spirit. We don't have to have, amen, the stone. And one case where Paul said, we don't have to have the letter so much. But now His Spirit is in our heart. That now we know when we're doing wrong because our heart lets us know by the Spirit of God that's on the inside of us. So every person has the Spirit of God on the inside of them. You know, but it's up to you to obey that voice. Just like y'all two sitting there looking at me, I guess y'all said, well, mom and daddy told me something, I did it anyway. But we all have. You ain't the only one. All of us have done that. But I want you to understand this. Remember to listen to the Spirit of God that's on the inside. You know, if the Spirit of God tell, and they're just like your parents. If they tell you not to do something, they're trying to help you. They're trying to hurt you. So it's love. You know, and you got to remember that. They're trying to protect you. And that's why God put the Holy Spirit on the inside of you. So the Holy Spirit will tell you, guess what? Don't do that. Victor, you know better. Sometimes the Holy Spirit still got to talk to me. Because sometimes the devil come against all of us. Ain't nobody perfect. But I yield to the Holy Spirit. Sometimes my flesh want to do wrong. But because I yield to the Holy Spirit on the inside of me, I go the other direction. I don't yield to it. You know, but it's because of the Holy Spirit. So we got to learn to listen to the Spirit of God on the inside of us. And see, this is one of the workings of the Spirit. You know, is that it'll let us know. Hey, don't you do that. So I want to encourage you, obey the voice of the Holy Spirit. Because the Bible said the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. How do you know that? There's a lot of people in this world that they grown, they can do whatever they want to do. You know, I remember when I was much younger, when I first turned 21, you know, hey, I can go buy me some beer, I can go buy me some liquor. Don't y'all bother me, I'm grown. Don't tell me I can't drink, don't tell me I can't party. But you know what I figured out in the long run? What's this? Just because I'm grown don't mean I'm right. And just because I can do it don't make it right. You know? And God is saying to us, listen, you got to make the right decisions. You got to hear the voice of God. I thought I was having fun, getting drunk, getting high, but I didn't realize I was killing myself. You know? But when I received the Holy Spirit, I feel better. You know? And I'm just being transparent and honest with you. When the Holy Spirit comes, He helps you. But listen to Him. Listen to His voice. I got a little niece. A great niece. And sometimes she would say this to me. She said, do you see that angel? Sometimes she could see angels in her room. You know? She would say, you see that? I go, you know, no, I don't see that. But she would see it. And sometimes she would say to me, she said, Victor, that's another old spirit in this house trying to make me do bad. And she said, I told it, no, I don't want to do that. I want to do what God tell me to do. Well, there are some people in life, and I'm making a point, that God has blessed them with gifts where they can see in the spirit realm. They can see things. It's actually called the gift of discernment. They can see. You know, they can sense things. I had this little girl from West Block. And we're talking about the administration of the spirit. But this young girl